Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hijinks by Kelley Armstrong, narrated by Carly Robbins and Emily Durante. Chapter 1.
Ooh, this doll definitely looks cursed, Hope says from across the shop where she's glued to my laptop, surfing eBay. When I don't respond, she turns the laptop around. Don't you think it looks cursed, Kennedy?
Bookmark it, I say. Right now, I'm a little busy with this mirror, which is definitely cursed.
We're in my antiques shop, which has been open for a month. It's mid-June, and I'm madly preparing for full-blown tourist season in Unstable, the little town where Hope and I live with our older sister, Ani. Tarani, Kennedy, and Hope Bennett. Yep, our parents named us after famous curses. Fitting for a family of curse weavers. At least half the items in my shop are formerly hexed objects. That's my specialty. In Boston, I'd hidden the formerly cursed part. In Unstable, it's a selling point. Right now, I'm trying to get this tabletop mirror uncursed before the shop opens. I've already had 3 people knock on the window. I'm considering investing in drapes. Luckily, in a town like Unstable, nothing intrigues people more than a shrouded store window. Hope walks up behind me and reaches for the sheet covering the mirror. I catch her hand.
Uh-uh. But I want to see.
No.
You looked. What did you see?
I don't answer. I try to focus on the mirror again, listening for the music of the curse.
Kennedy, she says, what did you see?
I glower at her. She sets her hands on her hips.
I don't see why you're removing the curse. It's a great tourist draw, a mirror that emphasizes your greatest flaw.
Yeah, and only someone who looks like you wants to see that. Hopeless. She rolls her eyes.
I already know what I'd see. My skin. I thought I'd stop getting zits when I turned 20. No longer a teen, right?
It doesn't work that way.
Did for you. Oh, wait, you never got zits. Anyway, if I already know my biggest flaw, what's the big deal?
The big deal is that there's a difference between knowing it and seeing it magnified 100 times. Your skin is fine. The problem is in your head. So now you want to see what's in your head actually showing on your face? No one needs that. It's a nasty little hex, and I'm getting rid of it. She's quiet for a moment as she leans against a butler's desk.
What did you see?
She asks, her voice softer now, concerned. Nothing. That's what I saw. I imagine telling Hope that. She'd tease me about thinking I'm perfect if I didn't see any exaggerated flaws. It's not that. I literally saw nothing. I looked into this cursed mirror, and there was no me. And I'm not sure how to interpret that. I'd panicked, as if I were looking into a scrying ball for my future and seeing none. That isn't it. That can't be it. It's just a hex. It's the sort of curse I specialize in, a Joker's jinx. Though, personally, I'd say this one edges closer to a misanthrope's malice. I like my jinx's fun, lighthearted pranks. This one bears the sharp teeth of cruelty, and I have no time for that bullshit. I keep telling myself that's why I don't see my reflection. As a weaver who specializes in the jinx, I see through it. Like on April Fool's Day, I saw through other kids' pranks and exposed the cruel ones, and the bullies who liked their jokes nasty stopped trying to play them on me. Pouted and said I was no fun, no fun at all, which always made my friends laugh. Kennedy Bennett, no fun? There's a reason I specialize in jinxes. I was the class clown, the carefree girl who adored a good prank, even if it was played on her. I just don't like cruel jokes. And so maybe this mirror is like those bullies, pouting and refusing to show me anything in its reflective surface. A good theory, and I don't believe it for a second. I saw your chin on my face. I shudder as I rise from crouching before the mirror. The stuff of nightmares.
We have the same chin, Kay.
Huh. Really? I tap mine. Looks better on me, though. She raises a middle finger.
I lift the shrouded mirror. Open the storage room. This hex is going to take a while to uncurse, and you are not going to let me concentrate. She opens the door. Because I want to see myself in it first. I set the mirror inside and shut the door. Then I take the keyring from my pocket and wave it before locking the door. Good luck with that, kiddo. Spoil sport. I know. I am no fun. No fun at all. I head for the sales counter. Now, show me this doll. Hope specializes in cursed dolls the way I specialize in cursed antiques. Her actual weaver specialty is the Lover's Lament, colloquially known as the X-Hex. As for the dolls, that would be my fault. Hope is 5 years younger than me, and as a proper big sister and a proper middle child, I'd done my best to terrify her. I'd tell her stories about cursed objects, especially dolls. Contrary child that she was, she loved it, and now has a room filled with formerly cursed dolls, and I have 4 of them in my shop. I'm still not quite sure how that happened. When I'd been low on stock, Hope insisted I take a few of her least favorite dolls on consignment. They'd sold within 2 days. I'm still half convinced she hired the buyers. I mean, who the hell walks into an antique shop, sees a creepy old doll with glass eyes that follow you across the room and says, "I want that in my house"? Apparently a lot of people, at least the sort who visit Unstable. So I now have 4 truly creepy dolls whose eyes follow me everywhere. And I have a summer employee in my sister who somehow went from, "Can you sell these old dolls of mine on consignment?" to spending her days here, which wouldn't be so bad if she didn't also expect a paycheck. When I move to the laptop, I resist the urge to pick up my phone and casually glance at my messages. Expecting a text, Kennedy? No, not at all. Wait, you weren't checking to see whether Aiden read your last message, were you? Ha ha, no, that's not me. I pop off dozens of texts a day, whether to my sisters or friends or clients, and I never check to see whether they've been read unless it's life or death urgent. Yet my fingers itch to pick up my phone, and my pride slinks down into my sneakers. I don't want to be this person. Definitely don't want to be this woman. Connolly and I aren't dating. We're friends. Have been for nearly a month. Would I like more? Yep, I won't deny it. But I'm currently under an unbreakable curse, one that will visit doom and despair on any guy who falsely claims to love me. That should be a good thing, right? Who doesn't want a romance lie detector? The problem is that I'm not sure that's how the curse works. It might also hurt a guy who thinks he's interested and later realizes otherwise, or who says he loves me and later realizes he doesn't. That's not curse-worthy. It's just part of picking your way through the minefield of romantic love, making mistakes, and figuring it out as you go. The truth is that while the curse scares me, it's also made me slow down, and that's a good thing. If I have a life motto, it's carpe diem. Looking before I leap is foreign to my DNA. When it comes to Connolly, though, I want to get this right. Therefore, I should be fine with him not rushing to answer or even read my texts, right? Take it slow, don't go wild, ease in. But he didn't ease in at first. Connolly is naturally reserved, with a kind of standoffishness that can be mistaken for arrogance and ego. And in Connolly's case, that wouldn't be entirely a mistake. Yet he was different with me. He'd send the first text of the day. He'd read my response right away. No games, and I appreciated that. But now something has changed, and I'm racking my brain to figure out what. I only know that he's no longer jumping at every excuse to hang out. I invited him antiquing in New Hampshire this past weekend, and he had jumped. Yes, that sounded like fun. He'd clear his schedule. He knew a great spot there for dinner. Then, 3 hours before he was supposed to pick me up, he texted to say he couldn't make it. He didn't call. He sent a vague, "something came up." Since then, he hasn't initiated a single conversation or answered a text within 30 minutes. I should take the hint, right? Say, screw him. If he's backing off, that's his loss, and it's not as if I'm sitting at home waiting for his call. That's what I want to say. Instead, it's like that empty mirror. I look into it and I feel as if there's a message I should understand, and I don't. I know I didn't do anything wrong, but a little voice keeps whispering that I must have, that I did something to deserve this. I shove my phone into my back pocket and look at the laptop screen. My cat, Ellie, hops onto the stool. She takes one look at the doll and hops down again. Yep, Ellie, that is one ugly doll. So, cursed? Hope says. Not every ugly doll is cursed. She rolls her eyes. It doesn't matter whether it's cursed or not. It looks cursed. That's what counts. It looks dead. She squints at the screen. Kind of? It looks like a dead baby. And that's a bad thing? Yes, kiddo, it's a bad thing. I wave at the shop. Our clientele is people like our parents, middle-aged, middle-class, looking for a conversation piece. A doll that looks like a dead baby is a conversation piece. Would Mom have wanted that in our living room? She sighs and slumps. As I pretend to tidy, I study her for a reaction to the mention of our parents. It's been 5 years since a careless driver stole our father, 2 years since cancer stole our mother. We are easing into a place where we can talk about them without diving into the tar pit of grief. And I'm glad of that. I don't want to talk around our parents. I want to talk about them. Bring them to life the only way we can. Fine. Hope flips to another browser tab. This one? It looks possessed, I say. So, yes? Yes. But if we don't sell it within a week, I'm turning it to face the wall for a timeout.
Ooh.
No. We should do that right away. Hang a sign warning that shoppers turn it around at their own risk. When I don't immediately say no, she brightens. I smile over at her. Yes, that'd be fun. This is why I'm going into marketing. Ani's the oldest 27-year-old on the planet, like a stodgy grandma. No hope, you can't run a sideline hexing exes. No hope, you can't vlog a client's cursed objects on your TikTok. No hope, you can't tell people they'll be eaten by a rabid dog if they don't get Aunt Maud's tea set uncursed. Gotta agree with her on the last one. But you'd be fine with the first two, which is why you, dear sister, will be the benefactor of my upcoming college education. I'm going to run all my test cases using your shop, right after I convert that corner, she points, into a cursed doll gallery. Four dolls, kiddo. We agreed on four. No more. I'm about to turn away when my gaze snags on the bottom of the web page. It disappears as Hope closes the tab. I take the laptop from her and reopen it, zooming to the suggested listings. The one I thought I'd seen doesn't appear. I type two words in the search box, and the entire page fills with results. Cursed paintings? Hope says. New sideline, Kay? I flip through the list, most of which is paintings of cats, which could mean the search engine thought that's what I mistyped. Or it could think it means the same thing. It wouldn't be wrong. I glance at Ellie, who's contemplating sharpening her claws on a 300-year-old chair. I scroll down and click a listing. A painting of a crying girl fills the screen. Holy shit, I whisper. That isn't creepy, Hope says. It's just depressing. You don't want that one. Here, let me... I smack her arm as she reaches across the keyboard. You don't recognize it? Should I? Salvo Costa. Crying Girl, the most famous cursed painting. Well, one of them. It was part of a quartet, all cursed. She frowns. You never read Mom's curse scrapbook, did you? I say. Just the pages on dolls. I sigh. Fine. Curse history lesson, just for you, baby sister. It's the 70s. Guy paints a series of sad kids. Why? Because it's the 70s and people ate that shit up. Or that's how it began. He only meant to paint one and have copies made. He holed up in his studio to do this painting, Crying Girl. When night comes, his wife brings him dinner, and he says to leave it outside the door. Doesn't touch it. Doesn't touch breakfast either. For 3 days, he drinks nothing but coffee. Lots of coffee. When he emerges, he's completed a series of four paintings, all of sad kids. Did anyone suggest therapy? No, but when his priest saw them, he suggested an exorcism. She peers at the screen.
It's just a crying kid.
While they're called the sad children, this is the only one who's crying. There's a boy about 13 who looks eerily determined. Determined to do what? That is the question. Then an older girl who looks as if she's lost her last friend in the world, and an older boy who looks as if he murdered that friend.
A wee bit too demonic for the priest's taste. As for Salvo Costa, all he wanted was to get the damned things out of his house. But he'd just finished painting them.
I shrug. That's the legend. He painted them and immediately wanted them gone. His art dealer took them and sold them. That's when the crying started for real.
Let me guess, they make people cry?
No, they kill. Violent death and madness follow the paintings wherever they go.
Ooh, now it gets good. It's story time, yes? Please tell me it's story time.
I lower my voice. They say that Costa was possessed by the spirits of the four children. He and his wife had just moved into a new home. Little did they know that it harbored a dark secret. My sister fairly vibrates with glee, and I have to bite my cheek to keep my expression suitably somber. An entire family died in that house, I say. Parents and their four children. They perished in a fire. Except, that's not the whole story. Hope bounces, glowing as if she's seven again, the two of us under her covers while I unspool a new ghost story. I continue. They say the parents died first, and it wasn't a fire. It was the children. I let that one hang for the required 3 seconds. They say the oldest girl and oldest boy murdered their parents, killed them in their sleep. For the next month, no one knew. The kids said their parents were busy, their parents were sick, their parents had just stepped out. All the while, they were rotting in their beds. The youngest girl wouldn't stop crying. She missed their parents and didn't understand why she wasn't allowed in their bedroom. Then came the fire.
Did the little girl set it?
That, my dear sister, is the question. Some say it was indeed the little girl. Some say it was the younger boy, the one who looks so determined in the painting, perhaps determined to punish his murderous siblings. Some say it was the older girl, and that explains her expression. She's broken by guilt and remorse. Or it's the older boy, who'd had enough of the crying and decided to stop it for good. There is another story, though. One where the youngest, the girl in this painting, escaped and ran to tell the neighbors. The neighbors came back and set the house on fire. At the last minute, they pushed the little girl into the flames to perish. After all, she shared the same blood as the two who'd killed their own parents. A bad seed. Hope gives a delicious shiver.
That's a good one.
I lean back. I think so.
Anyway, that's the origin story for the paintings, which this seller doesn't even seem to know. Lousy marketing, right?
I scroll through the listing. They don't seem to know there are other paintings either.
What about the deaths? Do the children come out of the paintings at night and kill the owners?
Kill them or drive them mad. Everyone who has survived insists they saw the child in their painting come to life. My guess is that the curse is actually a hallucination, causing the owner to believe they see... Hope sticks her fingers in her ears.
What's that? You're trying to explain away a cool story? La la la, I can't hear you.
I smile and shake my head. Fine. I'll keep my theory to myself. The point is that, yes, it's widely believed that the paintings are actually cursed and that the curse has killed people. Better?
Much.
And since it's a deadly curse on an item that is for sale, I am honor-bound to buy it and uncurse it, then resell it with the full story for double what you paid. That's the idea. I sign into my account. Looks like the bidding is at $100. Let's make it two. Chapter 2. I've lost hope. Three of them, in fact. One, I keep getting outbid on that damned painting. Two, I conceded defeat in the phone-checking battle, only to discover Connolly hasn't read my message. 3, I've lost the actual Hope, who got a call from Ani needing her at home. Ani runs the family business. Unhex me here. As the name suggests, they uncurse whatever people need uncursed, or more often, whatever people believe they need uncursed. Ani needed Hope to handle a client trying Ani's patience, which is honestly not hard to do. Business is brisk for a Tuesday. I've already sold 3 items, and I'm closing in on the sale of a doll. I may have told Hope that our clientele was mostly middle-aged antiquers, but her dolls and my jewelry finds pull in a different crowd. 50% Gen X former goths, 25% my fellow millennials, and 25% Hope's fellow Gen Zs. These 2 fall into the last category, trust fund babies who think that a cursed doll is exactly what their Tony Boston apartment needs. So ironic. Can you believe people actually thought it was cursed? So the curse has been removed, the blonde one says. You can guarantee that? I can guarantee that the doll is not cursed, because it never was. Is there a certificate or something? Blonde smirks at brunette. A certificate of decursing authentication? A click behind me, as Hope must come in the back door. Both young women look over. Well, hello, brunette murmurs. Please tell me you're for sale. I presume she's talking about my sister. Then blonde says, wait, wasn't that Aiden Connolly? I turn so fast my sneakers squeak. I don't see Connolly. I do, however, see the storage room door swinging shut. That was Aiden Connolly, blonde says, her voice as breathy as if she just spotted a movie star, which tells me 2 things. 1, Connolly just walked in the back way and immediately turned tail and fled. 2, I was right about the background of these young women. When I called them trust fund babies, I was kinda snarking. Seems I hit the bullseye because Connolly isn't a movie star. Unless you're a society girl who's memorized Boston's most eligible bachelor lists. Connolly is on those lists. Hell, he's in the top 3. Hope has shown me the lists. At first, I thought she was creating fake ones to tease me. Oh, I know Aiden Connolly is hot. I have eyes. Also, I know he's rich, son of a very wealthy old money family, and he has his own successful insurance company. But, well, he's Connolly. A little straight-laced, a little standoffish, not exactly a charming playboy. I mean, the guy runs an insurance company. He geeks out over actuarial tables. Except that kind of ambitious stability is catnip to many of the women who pore over those lists, as if they prefer the charming playboy. Well, there's always his younger brother, Rian, who has been secretly dating Hope for the past month. That was Aiden Connolly, Blonde says again. I know it was. Her friend curls her lip as she looks around. Here? No way. Yes way. I heard he's been slumming it with some... Blonde's gaze turns to me. Oh my God. I fix on my most neutral expression and pause before speaking, as if they are engaged in a personal conversation which I hate to interrupt. We don't have certificates of decursing authenticity, I say. However, I do offer a store guarantee. You may return the doll within 3 days, no questions asked. That was Aiden Connolly, wasn't it? Blonde asks. I pause, again so politely that Ani would be proud. Then I fix on my blank shop clerk look, the one that says I know my clients aren't addressing me. Hello? Brunette says, waving her hand in front of my eyes. We asked if that was Aiden Connolly who just came in your back door. I glance toward the back door and frown. Someone just dropped off a delivery. Is your friend a courier? I check my watch. Oh, would you look at the time? I'm sorry, ladies. I have a video sales appointment in a few minutes. Perhaps you'd like to think on the doll a little longer? I raise my voice loud enough to be heard in the storage room. Or perhaps if that delivery guy really was your friend, you can slip out the back door and catch him. The young women must not know Connolly personally, because they don't take me up on my offer, nor do they leave nearly fast enough, instead flouncing and whinging because I have the nerve to turn down a sale. The pair finally leave after shooting back that if I were really selling uncursed objects, I'd offer a certificate of authenticity. I return to my desk. Less than 10 seconds later, the storage room door creaks open before swinging wide as Connolly strides in. That was you, I say. Gaze on my phone as I check the cursed painting bid.
Yes, he says. I left my phone in the car.
A perfectly valid excuse if you're me, if you're Connolly. It's like saying you left your right arm behind. There's no reason for him to lie. He could admit he heard the young women recognize him and retreated because it made him uncomfortable, which is true. Plenty of guys campaign to get on those lists. To Connolly, it's like topping the list of prize-breeding bulls. Or, more accurately, top investment opportunities. He sets something in front of me. The smell of fresh bread wafts out, and I glance up to see a picnic basket, complete with a bottle of wine.
My apology for this weekend, he says. I'm hoping you'll have time for a picnic, but if you don't, consider this a delivery service.
I slowly lift my gaze over the basket, which is a mistake. I said Connolly was hot. I suspect he'd find that adjective as uncomfortable as being on those lists. That doesn't mean he hides his light under a barrel. I've been told that Connolly dresses extremely well. Maybe I should have realized that myself. But male fashion isn't my thing. Hell, female fashion isn't really my thing, as evidenced by the fact that I'm working in a t-shirt and sneakers. Connolly dresses as if he's heading to a GQ magazine shoot. Today, that's an ivory shirt tailored for his lean body, paired with a tie that I'm sure cost more than I'll make this week. He's on the other side of the counter, so I can't see the rest, but I'm sure it's not jeans and cowboy boots. He looks freshly shaven, gorgeous green eyes. The exact right number of freckles scattered over his nose, as if his creator counted them out, one by one. When anyone finds fault with Connolly, it's always his hair. Not the style, which is impeccable, between fashionable and corporate, with just enough wave for flair. It's the color that puts some people off. I happen to have a thing for redheads. So, yep, even this is a point in his favor. He reaches into the basket and pulls out a tin.
I brought brownies.
When I still don't answer, he shifts, almost imperceptibly. I'm usually the one who'll swing in, basket in hand, to tease him with sweets, a temptation he avoids.
I am sorry about the weekend, he says.
Ah, I count two beats. I didn't get that impression. I take out my phone, flip to the texts, and read his. I need to cancel this weekend. Something came up. Nope, nothing apologetic there. His brows knit.
Are you sure? I could have sworn I said more.
He shakes his head.
My phone has been misbehaving all week. I knew I should have held off on the software upgrade.
Ah. Here is the quagmire of a new friendship, especially one with the potential to become romantic. If I demand an explanation, am I being needy? Scaring him off? I hate the scaring him off part. It makes me sound desperate. I like Connolly because there's an amazing natural level of comfort between us. This is the opposite of that. Screw it. If Connolly is having second thoughts, if he's feeling pressure for slumming it, as those girls said, that isn't my problem. I don't want a friend who can be scared away by the expectation of common courtesy. I understand things come up, I say evenly. But we did have a weekend planned, and I had to scramble to make alternate arrangements. That deserved more than a 5-word text. He flushes, and I struggle not to be charmed by that. Fair skin means the guy blushes easily, and it is charming. It's also proof that he saw my point even before I brought it up.
I am sorry,
he says.
If I didn't text more, it's because I got caught up in the situation I was resolving. That's no excuse. I should have called.
Would you like me to stop texting you, Aiden? I ask. If so, just say that, please. He frowns. You aren't reading my texts, I say.
But I am. They come to my watch.
He holds up his wrist. It's a gold watch with an analog face, When I arch a brow, one corner of his mouth lifts, and he taps the face to reveal a digital version. Fancy, I say. Yes, well. He clears his throat and then injects a too bright note with, "You have told me I fuss with my phone in the car too much." "You do." "So I was receiving your texts, but as I planned this surprise visit, I decided not to respond until I saw you."
Maybe this should make me squirm, but it wasn't as if I was sending a dozen texts a day and freaking out when he didn't answer. It was our usual daily check-in, which he had started last month, texting me over his morning coffee each day and turning that good morning into a 20-message thread, casual back and forth as we got ready for our days, which turned into another dozen over the course of the day, more of them instigated by him than me. I'm not being needy. I'm not being demanding. He's changing the rules to a game he started, and I don't know why. He taps the basket.
"Do you have time for a picnic lunch?"
"I have an appointment in 30 minutes. Also, I lost hope, so I need to eat inside."
He waves at the showroom.
"Let's pull up a seat then."
My phone dings. I glance down at it and sigh. Then I swipe it open, explaining with bidding war. He takes the basket to a dining table, and before I can say we can't risk scratching that, he whips a tablecloth from the basket, a white linen tablecloth, with matching napkins. I'm still entering my bid as he sets out lunch.
"May I ask what you're buying?" he says. "If it's for the business, that is, and not personal."
"Cursed painting," I say.
"A painting you believe is cursed, or one advertised as such?"
"Both. Salvo Costa's Crying Girl." He pauses while dishing out salad. His head tilts as if accessing an inner data bank.
"I don't believe I've heard of that one."
"Because it's kitschy." I show him the photo, and he struggles against a moo of distaste that makes my lips twitch in a smile. Another ongoing mock battle of ours. His impeccable taste versus my predilection for, well, kitsch. "Even I wouldn't hang this in my house," I say. "Sad-eyed waifs are not my thing. Now, if it was a sad-eyed puppy," I catch his look.
"Kidding. No sad-eyed anything."
"But this is part of a quartet of infamous cursed paintings." My smile fades. "Dangerously cursed."
"Fatalities?"
"Yep, which is why I'm trying to buy it. Uncurse it if I can, and if I can't, then I'll get rid of it. Safely." I'm putting my phone down when it dings again. "Seriously?" I mutter. "Sorry about this."
"Canceling a weekend at the last minute is a cause for apology," he says. "Trying to remove a cursed object from the world is not."
I shift on the chair, hoping I don't look too uncomfortable. I want to be angry with him. Annoyed, at least. He's not making that easy. I open the bidding app and let out a profanity that has his brows shooting up. He sets down his sandwich as I show him the screen. "Some guy just doubled my bid." "It was already double what I wanted to pay." I don't say that. Even the current bid would be pocket change for Connolly. I turn over my phone and set it down. "I'll figure that out later. The auction doesn't close for another couple of days."
"Tell me about the painting."
I shrug. "Definitely cursed. Definitely lethal. Not much to say beyond that."
"Really?"
he murmurs.
"There's no story."
His gaze meets mine, green eyes glittering. He knows there's a story, and he knows I love to tell them. Still, I hesitate. Was this week a temporary withdrawal? He wasn't sure that he wanted to continue the friendship, and now he is? He has the right to reconsider, especially given my curse, if that's what he's done. And he's now showing me that he's past that. Then, okay, let's do this. I sip my wine. I take a bite of my salad. And then I start the story. Chapter 3. By the time I finish the story, we're done with the meal and ready for the brownies. I slip into the back to make coffee. There's a machine up front,
A one-cup brewer with inexpensive knockoff pods. That's fine for customers, and it's fine for me. Yet I've invested in a pour-over system in the back, along with single-origin coffee for the guy sitting out front. Not that he wouldn't drink the pods. I've seen him drink worse when his caffeine level runs low, but learning a new brewing technique and buying better beans is my way of showing that I get him. Am I overdoing it? Trying too hard? Gah, I'm overthinking this, and I don't like it. Don't like it at all. As I take him his coffee, he has my brownie set out, with his own cut into tiny cubes, and I have to laugh at that. It's an in-joke. I'd once cut his up when he was in the balancing phase of a luck roll. Connolly is a luck worker. He can manipulate luck. But when he does, he suffers a bout of bad in return for the good, when even a bite of brownie could send him into a choking fit. Ellie sits on a dresser, watching him, narrow-eyed, as she always does. I could take that as a bad sign, but she doesn't dislike Connolly. She's just suspicious of this new person in my life. Maybe suspicious of the role he's filling and how fast he's filling it. I pass over the coffee, and I'm about to sit when my phone buzzes. Oh, look, I mutter. The bid has gone up again. I flip over my phone and unlock it. The bid pops up. I read it and swear under my breath. Something wrong? Connolly asks as he eats a tidbit of brownie. Someone paid the full asking price. $2,000. That's inconvenient. He washes the brownie down with a sip of coffee. Is there any way of tracking the buyer? You could contact them and try to uncurse it. How? Oh, excuse me, that painting you bought really is cursed, but I can fix it. For free. I wouldn't say free. Ask for a few hundred and then negotiate. People are overly suspicious of free. I shake my head. While I highly doubt the buyer will let a stranger see their new painting, I can reach out. It's a username with an account. Damn, it's a brand new account, created a few minutes ago. Username, I glance up at him. Pot of Gold 7. You bought it. Me? His brows arch as he pops another brownie bit into his mouth. That sounds like a leprechaun reference. It certainly wouldn't be me. Did you just pay $2,000 for a cursed painting, Aiden? Certainly not, he says. I invested $2,000 in a painting that can be uncursed and resold. Not for $2,000. He lifts one shoulder in a shrug. One must make a few poor investments to properly appreciate the good ones. Somehow I don't think that's your family motto. He takes another bit of brownie. No, our motto is Oderint dum metuant. He pops the bit into his mouth. Let them hate so long as they fear. Well, I hate to break it to you, but I fear you've wasted at least $1,500. It's not wasted if it removes a cursed painting from the world. He lifts his coffee. Do they offer charitable donation receipts for that? I sigh. Then I meet his eyes. Thank you, Aiden, but you did not ask me to buy it, or even hint that you wanted me to. Allow me the occasional good deed, Kennedy, even if it doesn't earn a tax write-off. He checks his phone. It says the seller is in New York State. May I suggest we pick it up in person? Perhaps tonight? I peer at him. What's going on, Connolly? You just did a 180, from canceling our plans and ignoring my calls to buying me a $2,000 painting and wanting to drive 2 hours to pick it up. Is everything okay, Aiden? He meets my gaze again, locking it in. Everything is fine with us. I hesitate. I can't miss his wording. He's saying whatever is going on has nothing to do with me, which suggests something is going on. And you? I say carefully. Is everything okay with you? His cheek twitches, even as his gaze stays steady. Everything will be fine. I don't miss the nuances in that answer either. But it's all he's giving me, and I don't have the right to press for more. Sure, I say. I close at 5, and I'm free after that.
Excellent. I will make the arrangements and pick you up at 6. We'll have dinner in the city.
I'm waiting outside the house at 6. I have a backpack over my shoulder, one containing a lead-lined blanket that we call a curse shield. I'll need it to bring the painting back. Hope is with me, while Ani is in the house making dinner. When a car rolls up in front of the house, Hope bends and squints at the driver. The car stops, passenger window rolling down.
Traded your wheels, huh? Hope says. Gotta say, I like the other one better.
As do I, Connolly says. However, it's in the shop.
This is the courtesy car? Last time I took ours in, we got a 10-year-old Kia that leaked when it rained. Hope pats my shoulder. You kids have fun now.
Have you heard from Rian lately? Connolly asks.
Hope fixes on her blankest look.
Me?
If you do, please tell him I need to speak to him. It's urgent, and he isn't answering my texts.
I bite back the urge to snark that I know what that feels like.
I'll tell him, Hope says. But if you want him to answer, you have to stop marking them all as urgent.
I mark them all urgent because they always are.
Then maybe, just maybe, you could occasionally text him to say hello, and not only when there's a family emergency you think he's caused.
I don't think... Connolly cuts himself off. Point taken. However, you might also remind Rian that when I do message to say hello, he accuses me of checking up on him.
She sighs. Noted. I'll talk to him. Also, I'm going to start billing you two for sibling mediation services. I slide into the car and wave goodbye to Hope. I wait until we've reached the edge of Unstable before saying, "Everything okay with Rian?" He makes a noise in his throat. In the Connolly family, Aiden is the good son, the golden boy. Rian is the disappointment, the black sheep. All siblings are cast into stereotypical roles. In our family, Ani is the smart one, and I often feel overshadowed by that. Hope is the pretty one, and I feel overshadowed there, too. I'm the fun one, and they feel that shadow cast by that, as weird as it seems to me. But our roles were assigned by outsiders. To Mom and Dad, we were all smart, all pretty, all fun to be around, with Connolly and Rian. It was their parents who assigned their roles, and their parents who keep them in them, and their parents who use those roles to pit them against each other. Connolly must look after his wild young brother and rescue Rian from whatever scrapes he gets into, even if they're half a lifetime past being children. And even if Rian resents the interference, understandably so. It's messed up. That's all I can say. Hope wasn't joking about sibling mediation. It's almost like being an interpreter between people who don't speak a common language. When you say this, your brother hears that. When you do this, your brother feels that. I'm just glad that they're both willing to listen. I'm also willing to listen, yet Connolly only makes that noise in his throat that says, yes, there's an issue, but he doesn't want to discuss it. I'll deduce, then, that whatever's been wrong in the last few days does indeed have nothing to do with me. Another family emergency that Connolly got sucked into. He had to cancel our weekend, and he didn't mean to be so abrupt with it. He was just distracted. I can grumble that if it's not about me, then I shouldn't be affected. But while Connolly can be the model of considerate behavior, you don't grow up in a family like his without developing a strong kernel of self-absorption.
Hope's good for Rian, he says as we reach the highway.
Mm-hmm.
He glances over.
The question is whether Rian is good for Hope, with the answer being probably not.
I've come to accept that if she gets hurt, she's old enough to deal with it. He's good for her, too, in his way. My concern is mostly that he'll be careless with her. He hasn't been so far.
Agreed.
He exhales the word, as if in relief. You aren't your brother's keeper, Aiden. If Hope does get hurt, I'm not going to blame you. I'm just going to kick Rian's ass. His lips twitch.
I'll hold him down.
Thank you. His phone rings. With this not being his car, the caller doesn't show up on the dashboard. He doesn't check his watch, just taps the decline button. He knows who's calling, and I'd bet my life savings it's his mother. You need to set ringtones, I say, so you know who's calling.
I always know who's calling.
There's also a handy call block feature, or one that sends certain callers straight to voicemail. He only gives a humorless quirk of his lips. His phone rings again. Again, he taps decline.
Aiden, I say, not getting up in your business, but I'm guessing whatever's going on explains your sudden urge to fetch a cursed painting tonight.
A strained chuckle. I had hoped my motivation wasn't quite so transparent, but yes,
he hesitates.
Is that all right? I do think it's safer to get it ourselves. I wasn't trying to rope you into an unnecessary trip.
You didn't. He relaxes into his seat.
Then, yes, if you can temporarily block calls from my mother, I would appreciate that. I would have done it myself, but I told her I was working at home tonight, and she usually respects that.
I pick up his phone and then hesitate. Is his car really in the shop? His mother has been known to track him, going so far as to send security personnel to check up on him if he isn't where she expects him to be. She treats him like a teenager with a behavioral issue who's lost the right to privacy. He doesn't live under her roof. He doesn't work for her business. He doesn't give a damn about his inheritance. So she can't even hold that over him, yet she holds something, and we haven't reached the stage where I can ask. I only know that it's not a matter of telling him to cut the apron strings. These aren't apron strings. They're cast iron ankle monitors. I won't ask about the car. Better he thinks I buy the excuse than force him to admit he had to rent a car to play hooky with me. I open the phone. It's not your mom. It's someone named Taylor Silver.
His brows knit. That's the seller. Can you check for a message?
I hold the phone out for him to unlock it with his face. Then I tap voicemail and hesitate.
Ignore all the ones from my mother.
And your father?
My father's calling too? Now I'm really in trouble.
He rubs a hand over his face and murmurs an apology, as if that flicker of annoyance had been a raging tantrum. Sometimes I think a raging tantrum might do Connolly a world of good. Whatever lessons his parents have injected, they include keeping his cool at all times. And if that hardened into an icy wall that might be mistaken for arrogance and indifference, well, it's better than the weakness of an emotional reaction, right? I'm about to listen to the seller's voicemail when I notice another message. Oh, you also got a voicemail from a Theodora an hour ago. I'll let you listen to that, presuming it's business. He stiffens, hands clenching the wheel before relaxing.
Yes, I'll take it later. Thank you.
Not business, then. Theodora O'Toole. The surname screams Irish, and the given name screams money. Pretty name, I hear myself saying before I realize it. He makes a strangled noise, and my heart thuds down into my feet. I take a deep breath, as quietly as I can. If he's seen someone, that's none of my business. Easy to say, logical and rational, and inside me, something wilts. No, it is pulverized, like a flower crushed under a heel. It takes me a moment to remember why I'm holding his phone. Then I force myself and hit the play button on the seller's message. Hello? A woman's voice wavers with uncertainty. Mr. Connolly? I tried to message you on the platform, but I haven't received a response. I wanted... She pauses, and when she comes back, her voice is firmer. I needed to notify you that the painting has been sold to another buyer. No charge was made to your account, and I apologize for any inconvenience this may have caused. What? I say, my voice rising. She can't do that. Can I call her back, or do you want to? He doesn't answer. And when I look over, his gaze is distant. I remember the other message. I remember Theodora. He's still thinking about that. Still trying to figure out how to tell me. Stop it. Aiden, do you want me to call back?
I'm considering our options.
I relax a little. He switches lanes and then says,
I propose we don't return the call, that we pretend I didn't receive the message. I am driving, after all.
Show up on her doorstep expecting the painting? Make her face us when she says she sold it out from under you?
Precisely.
Chapter 4. After work, I'd changed my clothing in case Connolly's idea of dinner out was a place with a dress code. It's happened before, to our mutual embarrassment. I mean, if you're the kind of guy who dresses like him even on Saturdays, you don't realize when places have dress codes because no one ever stops you. Even if he's not wearing a tie and jacket, they'll make an exception because he's still better dressed than 3/4 of their patrons. On the other hand, if you're me, you can't remember the last time you went to a restaurant with a dress code. So, while I'm not exactly in black tie garb, I am wearing a dress and low heels, and I'm glad of that as we walk to Ms. Silver's front door. I look as if I'm with him, and not an employee he brought along to carry the painting. He rings the bell. When no one answers, he pushes again, harder. The door cracks open, and the sliver of a woman's face appears.
Hello?
Aiden Connolly, he says. I've come for my painting.
Didn't you get my message?
He frowns. Message?
I called.
He takes out his phone. Ah, I have it on Do Not Disturb when I drive. Did you need me to meet you someplace else to pick it up?
I can't sell you the painting.
He stares at her for 5 excruciating seconds before speaking, annoyance sharpening his tone. I said it was a 2-hour drive and you called when I was already on the road. Is there an issue with me taking possession tonight?
She takes a deep breath. I sold the painting to someone else.
Silence. Connolly lets it stretch a beat too long before he says, I believe I misheard. You seem to have said you sold it to someone else, which cannot possibly be the case because I bought it. He looks her square in the eye. In good faith. This is where he wields his privilege, his bearing, his expression, even his accent, more Boston than my own, more clipped and cultured. The guy bought a cursed painting off eBay, but he acts as if he purchased an old master from Sotheby's, and the seller quails under that look. Did I not agree to pay the asking price?
Yes, but
did you not accept that offer?
Yes, but
do I not have, he raises his phone, proof that you accepted my offer on a legitimate sales website? His chin jerks up, as if a thought has just occurred to him. Did you perpetuate a scam, Ms. Silver?
What?
A scam. I purchased goods intended to be sent through the mail, across state lines, which makes this a federal offense. You intended to take my money and withhold the goods, only I arranged to pick them up at an additional fee, despite saving you the mailing charge, and you didn't know how to say no without it seeming suspicious, so you agreed and then messaged me that it was already sold, meaning I cannot prove you never had the goods in the first place. Or so you think. Fraud can certainly be proven. My lawyers will make sure of it. She tries to withdraw. Yes, it is your right to close the door, Ms. Silver. I will take that as a sign that you wish me to leave your property, which I will do. At that point, the matter is in the hands of our respective attorneys. I will leave my lawyer's card in your mailbox. It's a small firm and perhaps not terribly impressive, but that is the price one pays when one's family employs their own team of lawyers. She stops closing the door.
It wasn't my fault.
Does that mean you wish to discuss compensation?
Compensation?
Not money. Though if the lawyers are involved, obviously money will be required. They may be employed by my family, but that does not mean their work comes free. I believe their current rate is $500 an hour. However, it is my hope that we can resolve this without involving lawyers or any form of cash compensation. The door cracks open a little more. She says nothing, just waits. Let us start with you explaining how you came to sell my painting to another buyer.
I didn't want to. He threatened me with legal action, just like you're doing.
I'm threatening you because you committed fraud against me. What was his excuse?
He painted it.
I rock forward before stopping myself. Connolly nods toward me. This is my partner, Ms. Bennett.
Her gaze travels over me, and I feel the weight of the assessment. She's trying to figure out whether he means business partner or personal, and I'll admit to being gratified that the answer doesn't seem immediately obvious.
Ms. Bennett is an expert in the field of anthropologically significant art,
Connolly says. Anthro, she repeats.
This painting is the subject of a well-known urban legend, as you alluded to in your listing. Ms. Bennett believes it is the original, and she came to confirm that before I bought it.
You said the artist bought it? I say. The original artist. I'm presuming he showed identification?
I,
she begins. Then she opens the door a little wider as she nods decisively.
Salvo Costa was the name of the painter, and it was also the name on his credit card.
So Mr. Costa contacted you and offered to buy it for more?
No. He contacted me and insisted on buying it for the asking price, or he'd call the police and say I was selling stolen artwork. She straightens. If it was stolen, I knew nothing about that. I bought it in good faith from a reputable dealer. I tried to say that, but Mr. Costa started rattling off legal gibberish. I'm not an art dealer. I'm just a regular person trying to make a little extra to get by. I decided that if he was willing to pay the same as the buyer, then there was no reason I couldn't sell it to him.
Except that it's a clear violation of eBay's policy, and also a really shady business practice.
I didn't have a choice. He's the artist.
Right, and if I sew a dress and sell it to you, is it still mine? Can I ask for it back? Demand to buy it back? Mr. Costa gave his art dealer that painting right after he finished it in 1977. It sold within a week. It has not belonged to him since.
But he said,
do you even know how old he'd be now? I say, over 80. Did you see him?
He sent someone to pick it up an hour ago.
That was quick, I murmur, just low enough for Connolly to hear. He tilts me a nod and says to Ms. Silver,
then there is no point in pursuing this matter with you. We will take it up with Mr. Costa directly. I presume he provided contact information. We'll need that. Everything you have, including a description of whoever picked it up.
She pulls back.
I'm not sure I should give you that.
All right, then. We are back to lawyers again.
He takes a card from his pocket. I will notify them to expect your lawyer's call. Is 1 hour sufficient? She hesitates.
It's your choice, I say.
We're eventually going to need to pursue it with Mr. Costa in small claims court. We can speak to him directly with the information you provide, or we can get the lawyers involved. Mr. Costa lied to you. You legitimately owned that painting, and he bullied you into breaking faith with a customer.
He did, she murmurs. He was very abrasive.
Which you did not deserve, and now he's endangered your reputation by forcing you to violate eBay's policies. If Aiden reports it, you'll lose your account and everything you've built on that platform. That's not fair. You're a small business owner, and Mr. Costa screwed you over.
He did.
Then do you allow him to keep screwing you over? Or do you let Aiden, with his very expensive lawyers, show up on Mr. Costa's doorstep instead? Her lips curve as she envisions that.
Come in, please, she says. I'll give you what I have.
I am sorely tempted to have a little chat with Ms. Silver about the dangers of inviting online buyers into your home. Of course, one could argue then that we're equally gullible for walking into her house. Still, we're careful, only stepping into her front room and keeping the path to the door open, with my weapon and Connolly's luck at the ready. I have a gun in my purse. That's not the real weapon, though. It's not a weapon at all, considering it's a modified paint gun. The real weapon is my magic eight ball I always bring on curse-related jobs, just as Connolly needs to balance his good luck with bad. I need to balance my uncursing with cursing. I cast them all into a magic eight ball. Curse bomb at the ready. I don't need my gun here, or my curse bomb, or Connolly's luck. Ms. Silver is exactly what she seems to be, a seller who was taken advantage of by a bully and is eager for retribution. Miss Silver hasn't been in the online business long. She stumbled into it after reading an article about someone paying a few hundred for a fountain pen once owned by Al Capone. Miss Silver hatched a scheme. Sorry, business plan. To buy objects with a colorful history and leverage the story during resale. I could roll my eyes, but that would be wildly hypocritical given what I do for a living. I'm only amused that she still seems surprised anyone was willing to shell out $2,000 for a cursed painting. Obviously, she's never set foot in Unstable. She'd bought the painting in an estate sale. The previous owner had died, which may seem suspicious, but he'd been 70 and in hospice care, never having had any trouble with the painting. She got it cheap and put it up for sale this morning. It might seem like incredible luck that we found it on the first day of sale, but credit goes to the platform's algorithm. Hope was searching for cursed dolls, so eBay also suggested its newest cursed object. Ms. Silver provides us with the details she was able to get from Mr. Costa. I'm damned sure the buyer wasn't actually the artist. While she gives us an address, I'm sure it's fake. I'm also not sure what we'd do even if it isn't.
Follow up, of course,
Connolly says as I ask this once we're back in the car.
It's less than an hour away. While I agree it's likely a fake address, we should check it. Either way, we'll find that painting.
I bite my lip against the obvious question of why. Yes, when I saw the painting for sale, I wanted it. An infamous cursed painting for a couple $100? Hell yeah! Buy it, uncurse it, and resell it. Altruism plus profit. It doesn't get better than that. Then Connolly bought it at a price I almost certainly can't recoup. I'd felt a nudge of guilt, scrubbed away by the reminder that he didn't expect full repayment, and uncursing it was a good deed. If he wanted to drive and pick it up, I could justify that too. A cursed object isn't something you should toss into a FedEx box. But now the painting is gone, and our only leads are almost certainly fake. This is where we need to stop. To say that we've done our best, it's not as if the painting hasn't been in the world for decades, along with three others, and I've hardly felt compelled to track down any of them. My mother's scrapbook of famous cursed objects is thicker than any published book on the subject, and half of those would be fakes. Her book contains only the real thing. I've only ever seen three of those objects, one that my grandmother uncursed, one that my mother did, and then the necklace of Harmonia, which I uncursed, and in doing so, took on the curse myself. In an ideal world, I'd devote my life to tracking down those infamous objects and removing the terrible curses. In that ideal world, I'd also have a multi-million dollar trust fund, plus the skill set of a trained private investigator and undercover operative. In other words, the best I can do, like my mother and grandmother did, is keep my eye out for those objects crossing my path. Now one has, and as much as I long to pursue it, I know that makes no practical sense. I have spotted one deadly fish in the sea, and I cannot dive in after it, but I want to. Damn it, I want to. Connolly is offering to help me dive in after that fish. The guy who does have that multi-million dollar trust fund, plus the skill set of an insurance investigator. So why argue? Because I'm me, and I can't let him dive into dangerous waters without warning. Should we bother? I say. Even if it's the real address, this guy's not going to sell us the painting.
We don't know that until we try.
He glances at his watch.
Oh, I did promise you dinner, didn't I?
That is the least of my concerns, Aiden.
If you're worried about the time, he taps the address into his phone GPS. We're long past rush hour, so we should be able to eat, check the address, and return you to Unstable by midnight. Is that all right?
That means you'd be home after one. On a weeknight.
There are benefits to being the boss.
His voice is a little too chipper, as if he's forcing himself to remember that he is the boss. Aiden, I take a deep breath. I get that you want a distraction,
and I'm more than happy to provide one, if that's why we're doing this. He straightens.
No, no, of course not. While I welcome the distraction, I wouldn't drag you all over New England for that. This painting bears a terrible curse, and if you can remove it, regardless of whether we can purchase it, that is for the best.
I wait as he drives to the highway, then I twist to face him. I can't sneak into the room and uncurse it while you distract the owner. It'll take time.
Then I'll buy the painting.
I'm saying that if you need tonight as a distraction, I'm here for it. I'm here for you, Aiden. We can track down this painting, or we can grab a burger and drive all night. I don't care. I just don't want you running around chasing a cursed painting because you think I need it. I meet his gaze. Or because you think I'm upset over last weekend. Yes, I was annoyed. I worried that I'd done something wrong.
You didn't, he says emphatically. It was absolutely not you.
Or that it was us. Our friendship. You were pulling back, which is your prerogative.
It wasn't you and it wasn't us. If I thought you might think that, I would have clarified. This is my problem. It does not...
He trails off and snaps out his sunglasses before realizing the sun has sunk too low to need them. He hesitates, glasses in hand, as if robbed of the chance to hide behind them.
It does not directly have anything to do with you, he says.
I remember that name flashing on his screen, Theodora O'Toole. It does not have anything directly to do with you, Kennedy. I would like to check out that address, I say, whether it's to distract you from an external issue or just for the sake of crossing that off the list, since we're in the area. He exhales and signals to change lanes for the highway.
Excellent.
I'd like something else, I say. In the interests of being honest, something is going on with your family. I know it's none of my business, but if you'd like to talk about it, I'm here. As I said, I just need a yes or a no so I stop hovering, wondering whether I should push. Do you want to talk? Or should I drop it? He turns onto the highway, drives another mile before saying,
I believe we should discuss it as it does.
He clears his throat.
It tangentially involves you, though I am trying very hard to keep you out of it.
Another throat clearing.
We should talk. Perhaps over dinner?
Let me find something along the way. Chapter 5. We're at a cafe. I get a salad with enough feta and pecans and candied fruit to ensure it's no healthier than a fast food burger. Connolly is far more virtuous, as always, selecting a baby greens salad and wrap. It's a warm night, and we take our food outside to eat. We're the only customers on the patio. The only customers at all, with the shop due to close in 5 minutes. I eat my salad and sip my seltzer as Connolly picks at his food. Then he says,
My parents have decided it's time for me to get married.
My head jerks up so fast that, for a second, I'm sitting with lettuce hanging from my mouth, like a cow disturbed at the trough. I quickly shovel it in and swallow before I laugh, tension leeching from my shoulders.
Ah,
I say. You are closing in on 30. After all,
I'm 28.
Like I said, closing in on 30, I grin at him. Time to start pumping out little Connollys. I expect him to at least roll his eyes. He only stabs his salad. I'm kidding, Connolly. Your parents might want grandbabies, but you are under no obligation to provide them. He keeps eating. Aiden, is this an inheritance thing? Or a trust fund thing? His gaze cools.
I do not care about my inheritance or about my trust fund.
I'm sorry, that wasn't an insult. I got an inheritance and technically it's in a trust fund. I've drawn from it before and I will again. No judgment here.
Your situation is different,
he says, his voice softening.
And I didn't mean to get defensive.
Point is, you don't need money. Your parents can want grandbabies all they like, but they're stuck hinting and grumbling. Like every other parent with adult kids.
It's,
he stabs a tomato,
different
for us.
Different how?
New England luck workers practice arranged marriage.
I blink. Then I blink some more before I manage to give a strangled, what?
Arranged marriage. It's common in many cultures. His voice takes on a clipped tone. In our case, it isn't religion. It's custom. To keep the magical bloodline strong, we marry within it.
I remember hearing that his parents were both luck workers. I'd gotten the impression that was by design rather than choice, but I hadn't made the jump to arranged marriage. All right, I say slowly. So your parents are arranging your marriage, and you're dealing with the stress of that. I'm sorry if it seemed as if I was mocking your traditions. He stares at me for a moment, and then makes a strangled sound halfway to a laugh.
I don't want my marriage arranged, Kennedy. I want to marry whomever I choose, whenever I choose.
I keep my face passive and pray I don't look as relieved as I feel. So tell them no. You're financially independent. The only thing they hold over you is their love. Now I really have to keep my face straight in hopes I don't give away my thoughts on that. They'll be disappointed, maybe even angry. But ultimately, you're their son. They won't stay mad for long. I quirk a smile. Hey, you might even get a few interference-free months out of it. He doesn't return the smile, doesn't meet my eyes, just pushes around the salad on his plate.
I am not entirely financially independent. I owe a debt I cannot yet repay.
Okay.
When I received my admission letter for Harvard, I made an agreement. And when I turned 18, I signed the contract for that agreement. My parents paid for my tuition. In return, I agreed to allow them to arrange my marriage. If I default on that, I owe the tuition. Immediately.
My mouth opens and closes at least 3 times before I say the only thing that comes to mind. That can't be legally binding.
Forcing me into an arranged marriage wouldn't be. But by tying the contract to my tuition, they circumvent that. The marriage is a private matter, which the court would remove from its consideration, leaving only the debt, due to be repaid by my 30th year. I thought that meant when I turned 30.
I wince. It means when you turn 29. His lips twist.
If only I'd had you to consult with before signing. My parents verbally led me to believe the money was due when I turned 30. That was the age that stuck in my mind. And if I ever revisited the contract, I skimmed that part for other details.
They misled you, used archaic wording, and let you misunderstand it. Then, when the time drew near, if you wanted to repay it, you'd think you had another year to get the money together.
Yes,
he says finally.
Exactly that.
You did plan to repay it, right? I ask. This is the longest pause yet, and he visibly shifts in discomfort. Deep breath.
When I agreed to the contract, I was not vehemently opposed to an arranged marriage. I grew up expecting it, and at the time my parents seemed to have a strong relationship, as did other members of our circle. It's not as if my parents would choose a woman and force me to marry her. I would have multiple potential partners whom I would get to know.
I'm sorry, I say. My question was presumptuous. I know people who come from cultures that arrange marriages, and sometimes it works out a lot better than the alternative. I apologize for sounding judgmental.
You didn't expect it from my particular cultural background. It was a shock.
He sips his coffee.
I would like to say that I have been saving to repay the debt since I graduated. But my early profit went into repaying the startup loan to my parents and then expanding the business. The contract had no effect on my relationships. I dated whomever I wanted, with no interference from my parents. Had I been serious about anyone, I suspect that would have changed. But it was never an issue.
I remember the first time we met. He'd checked that I was actually a curse weaver using an X-hex. A mirror supposedly given to him by a former lover after he'd broken it off when she became serious. The lie had come easily to him, so much so that I never questioned it, which makes me suspect it was a variation on a situation he'd encountered before. Young, wealthy, handsome, and single. He'd have had no problem finding women, but his job and his ambition meant that none of those relationships approached a level of commitment his parents deemed dangerous. He continues,
"If anything, knowing my parents would help me find a life partner freed me from looking for that. I could enjoy company without commitment. The fact I was never tempted to commit also seemed to support their philosophy. Then, 2 years ago, Rian asked how much I'd saved to get out of my contract."
My sister's face flashes. Rian is under the same contract, isn't he? Connolly shakes his head.
Rian refused to sign, so my parents refused to pay for his education, and he had to drop out after his first year.
I say nothing, but my expression must speak for me because Connolly nods.
Yes, that was a horrible thing for my parents to do, and I regret that I didn't realize it at the time. To me, it was just Rian being his usual contrary self. It wasn't as if he cared about school. Wasn't as if he'd gotten into Harvard.
He makes a face.
Yes, I was an ass. Nothing new there. But then he mentioned it, presuming I planned to save up the money. That made me think. I spent a year mulling it over before deciding, yes, I should repay it. I still intended to let my parents suggest possible partners, but I wanted the freedom to buy my way out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.